My voice is very visible, sorry, audible.
श्री सुगम
सरी रसे
Good afternoon, one and all. Myself, Santosh Kurpade, Assistant Professor, Department of Physics. I welcome you all for this national level online seminar on challenges in space science for youths. Welcome you all. First of all, I welcome our beloved principal, Dr. L.D. Varkeri, sir, to welcome the participant as well as resource person, Anil Sri Mathur, sir, for this function. Over to Varkeri, sir.
Yes, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You are audible.
Yes. Good afternoon to one and all present over here for this online seminar, which has been organized by Department of Physics of our college on challenges in space science for young students, I mean youths. So on this occasion, we are very much having with us now Sri Anil Chand Mathur, Group Director, Retired Space Application Center, Indian Space Research Organization, that is ISRO, Hyderabad from Gujarat. So sir is going to talk on challenges in space science for youths. So it is a very challenging issue nowadays. So space science is a fascinating branch of science, which is more interested also, so that the young students of our college and those who have joined this webinar, I definitely express my opinion that they will be getting benefited out of this talk. So on behalf of our college staff, students, I extend a warm and sincere welcome to Sri Anil Chand Mathur, sir. Welcome you, sir. Welcome you, sir. I extend a warm welcome to all my colleagues and staff members from different colleges who have joined this webinar. And I also extend my warm welcome to all the students who have joined for this webinar. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Now I request our beloved head of the department, Dr. P.R. Jagal, sir, to introduce the resource person, Anil C. Mathur, sir.
Good afternoon to each and everyone. Am I audible, sir? I, Dr. P.R. Jirgal, head of the Department of Physics, would like to introduce the resource person of today's online seminar, Sri Mathur, sir. Sri Anil Chand Mathur did his schooling in Ghaziabad and graduation and post-graduation both in mechanical engineering from University of Roorkee, now IIT Roorkee, in the year 1977 and 1988 respectively. In September, that is 1978, he joined as a scientist engineer at a space application center, ISRO, Ahmedabad. From 1979 to 1982, he was involved with the education of India's largest satellite Earth station, that is the project, that is the INSAT satellite, Control Earth Stations. He was involved in mechanical design, fabrication, and installation of two large size, fully steerable antennas for the INSAT MCF project at Hassan in Karnataka. he was involved in the design and development of a number of antenna and feed systems for various satellite projects like INSAT, GSAT, RISAT, OceanSat, etc. He has a very rich experience in design, fabrication, assembly and installation of a number of large size satellite. He headed the fabrication and integration section for many years. He was a design. He designated as a project manager of INSAT 3A and INSAT 3C spacecraft antenna. There is a project in the year 1998. In the year 2000, he was designated as a head of a division of antenna mechanical design, division of antenna system mechanical group, which he continued till the year 2014. He also headed the antenna systems a mechanical group from the year 2014 to 2017 as a group head and a group director. He had published, there is a 50 research papers on antenna design and manufacturing in various national and international conferences and journals. He has 2 patents to his credit. Sri Mathur was instrumental in creating and establishing the Space Society of Mechanical Engineers at Ahmedabad. He held the post of a secretary, vice president, and president of SSME, that is, for many years. In the year 1994, he was appointed as the organizing secretary for organizing the first national level seminar on mechanical engineering challenges in development of antennas at SIC, Ahmedabad. He has organized a number of national and international level conferences on composite and smart materials. He retired on superannuation in April 2017 from ISRO, Ahmedabad, as a group director, after working in various capacities for 39.5 years. He is presently actively involved in spreading knowledge of space mechanical engineering and sharing his experiences to the young mechanical engineering students and the faculty members in the country. He has also registered a micro venture named Indian Space Industry Exhibitors in the year 2018 under MSME New Delhi to carry out space education and awareness related activities that is for the young students, faculty and professional engineers. In the year 2019, he established a space science gallery at Ghaziabad near Delhi for the awareness of a school and college students. During COVID-19 lockdown, he has written a booklet, First in Space, for reading by space enthusiast. There is a sir, Anil sir, he is mechanical, B mechanical, ME mechanical. Now he is a life member. There is a Space Society of Mechanical Engineers, life member of Astronautical Society of India, life member Indian Society of Remote Sensing, life member and a fellow, there is a Institution of Engineers, ex-secretary, ex-vice-president and ex-president SSME Ahmedabad. There is a sir, Anil Mathur sir, retired but not tired. He is rendering his service to create the interest and in the field of space science. On behalf of PC Sapin Science College faculty from the Department of Physics and the college, once again, I'm going to extend a warm and hearty welcome, sir. With this one now, I'm going to introduce the great personality, of a resource person, Anil Mathur sir. Thank you and all.
Thank you so much, sir, for your wonderful presenting the wonderful resource person of today's seminar, Anil C. Mathur, sir. Now I request the resource person, Anil C. Mathur, sir, to have a glance on the today's topic, challenges in space science for youths. Over to Anil, sir. Anil, sir.
Okay. Very good afternoon to all of you. And thank you very much, Dr. Jiragal, for giving a very detailed introduction about me, said a lot of good things about me. Let me thank your principal, Dr. Horakari, for inviting me to deliver this talk online to the young science students of PC Jabin Science College. I would also like to thank Dr. Veena, who was very instrumental last 15 days in organizing this particular topic. She was interacting me since last 15 days, and today the day has come and I am here with you all. So for my today's talk, I'll take around 1 to 1.5 hour. Hopefully all of you have that much time to listen me, and during my talk I will cover about the history of ISRO, how ISRO came up, what are the various activities of ISRO, and what are the challenging jobs for the academic institutions in the country, and especially all science students, how science is important, especially physics part of it, then how you can interact with ISRO for your research projects. So just I'll briefly touch all the aspects so that all young students, those who are attending this particular talk, they know about all these things. Usually the researchers and the student, they when they want to have some research project from ISRO, or they want some grant, or they are in search of a good topic, they don't know how to proceed, where to proceed, to whom we should contact. So I'll try to cover all that in brief. Okay, I'll request organizer to allow me to share my screen.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Now you can share.
Okay.
It is allowed, sir.
Can you see?
No, sir. No, sir.
It's not shared. Okay. I'll do stop sharing again, share the screen.
So now you can share, sir. Share option is enabled now.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Now it is.
It is there. Now you can you see?
Yeah, sir. Yes. Thank you, sir. Now you can proceed.
Okay. I think I'm end of my presentation. Just wait a minute. Okay. Let me start. This is my first slide. My topic is opportunities and challenges for young students in space science and technology. At the center of it, you can see the first Indian satellite, Aryabhatta. Then you can see Dr. Vikram Sarabhai and the first satellite, which was launched by Russia in 1957. Okay, slide also is not able to change. So I'll just tell you about the space definition, how you will define a space. Now everybody says we have sent our satellite to space, we have sent our rocket to space. What does it mean? So there are various definitions available if you see in the literature about the space. And the simple thing is, we call it when we cross over the gravitational limit and we go beyond that, and that is called space. Internationally, it has been defined as the Kármán line at 100 kilometers. And if you cross that Kármán line, then everything comes under space. But the other limit of the space, nobody knows. The space is so big. We start after 100 kilometers, where it ends. Lot of research is going on. Lot of efforts are going on. As on today, nobody knows. Maybe in future, somebody will find out where is the end of this space. And you know, we are living on Earth. We have some environment. And when we go to the space, the environment is totally different from the Earth. We have temperature ranges from here minus 50 degrees centigrade to sometime plus 40, plus 45. India, if you go to the Rajasthan area in summer, you get around 45 to 50 degrees centigrade. But when you go to the space, the temperature varies from minus 80 to plus 250 degrees centigrade. And you can think of what happens if we are at minus 80 or we are at 100 degrees centigrade and beyond. So we cannot survive under these temperature ranges. Okay. So if we design any system on Earth which has to work in space, we'll have to go through all these. We should know about the space environment. We should know the temperature limits. For this temperature limit, we will have to design that system. So without any proper space suit or without any thermal wear, we can't go outside in the space because we will burn. Temperature is so high. Okay. Another property in the space is there is a high vacuum. On Earth, there is no vacuum. You know, there is a medium. We have got an air. We are able to talk and we are able to breathe. But when you go to the space, there is no medium like air and there is a high vacuum. So it means we can't talk to each other. The sound waves does not travel without a medium. So UV radiation, is the dose is very, very high in space. We also get these radiations at Earth also. You know, the sunlight, these radiations comes from directly from the sun. You can see the plastic shades and other items. If anything we keep outside, then it gets very brittle. So that is the effect of ultraviolet radiation. But when we go to the space, we get pure form of ultraviolet radiations, and which are very, very harmful to our equipments as well as to our body. Okay, then another property is zero gravity. You know, Earth, we have got a value of G. Okay, because all of you are physics students, you know who invented about gravity, and we have anything which we throw up, it comes down. But in space, the gravity is zero. Once we cross 100 kilometer Kármán line, we will feel weightlessness. It means there is no value of G. So any system which we design, whether it is on Earth, which has to work in space, the gravity has to be zero. And the system has to be tested under zero G environment before sending to space. Another important property is outgassing. Outgassing is a very unique property of materials which you will not find on the Earth. So any material, whether wood, steel, aluminium, if we take it to space or in vacuum, they start producing some sort of gas because there is a vacuum in space, and these gases are harmful. It affects the performance of our system. So for designing anything, for doing any research on the system, you should have a clear cut idea about its environment. All these things, all we know a lot of things because so many people have gone into space in the last 50 years and they have given a lot of data to us. Now space is such initially started sometime in 1950s when the interest was created in the countries like USSR and America, and they thought, okay, let us send a satellite to space, and they started working on that. So Russia was the first country who sent their first artificial satellite to space. That was Sputnik 1. You can see the photograph at the bottom. It was on October 4th, 1957. And after a few months, the Americans, American Space Agency, NASA, they also sent their first satellite, and that was Explorer 1, and they sent it on 31st January 1958. So Americans were second in sending the satellite to space, and from 1957 you can say the space is started, and there were a lot of competition between these two countries to grab the space. Now all over the world, now these space agencies, they have decided the 4th October is celebrated as World Space Week. So all space related organization in all the countries, plus educational institutions and other professional bodies, they do a lot of activities on World Space Week, that is 4th October to 10th October every year. In India also, in all the ISRO centers, we celebrate 4th October to 10th October as World Space Week. We organize a lot of lectures, visits of astronauts, and all school children, they come to space center, they discuss with all the scientists who are working, they remove their doubts. So I request a college also, the next year you can also organize some program on World Space Week. What are our major activities when we say that we are working into the space? Major activities are design and development of spacecrafts, rockets, and spaceports. Then a lot of assembly, integration, and testing work. We make these components and then assemble them, integrate them, and test them. After that only they are sent to space. So once a satellite is sent to the space, we do all operation and control of those satellites from the ground. So we have got very big and large number of ground station at various places from where we control the flight of the rockets as well as flight of a satellite. So the last is applications, which is a very important part of the total activity, space activity, because we can send a satellite to the space, but the use of the satellite in space, how it is useful to the society or how it is useful to the common man of the country and to the scientist. Okay, scientists do their own research, but we should see there are large number of applications of satellite being in space, which we use at the ground. This is the list of major space agencies in the world. Okay, you, all of you may be knowing, you must be reading the newspaper and as well as on the TV media, that NASA is American Space Agency. It is the government of America Space Agency, which is responsible to carry out all space activities. Same way, we have got a ESA, European Space Agency. Then we have got Roscosmos, Russian Space Agency, Canadian. Like that, there are more than 12 agencies all over the world which are become very, very active to do research and development in space. So ISRO is the government of India's space agency, which is responsible to carry out the space research and development work in the country. Now ISRO is also in the recent policy changes, they are allowing a lot of private entrepreneurs, private companies, and academic institutions to participate in India's space program and contribute. Okay, India's space programs, this photograph you can see, you may recognize because all of you are physics student. Is Dr. Vikram A. Sarabhai. He was from Gujarat and he was from physics background. He was a physicist and he started physical research lab in Ahmedabad, and he was the director of physical research lab when he put up this proposal to do space activities in the country. So we call Dr. Vikram Sarabhai as father of India's space program. And he born in Gujarat. His family is basically business family, and most of the people in his family do the business. He was the only person, exceptional case, who did not do business and came into the research field. And he was a visionary. He was a dreamer, and he could visualize that space research, which was started by Russia and America in 1957 and 58, has a lot of potential in the country. So he submitted a proposal that time. and see the his vision. He established 5 to 6 great organization in Ahmedabad. That is first his physical research lab, from where our space program started. Then ISRO, Indian Institute of Management, National Institute of Design, and ATIRA. So earlier days, we had only one department, scientific department, that was Department of Atomic Energy. It is the oldest department, and physical research lab, which was established at Ahmedabad, it was under Department of Atomic Energy. The headquarters was in Bombay, and Dr. Sarabhai submitted a proposal through chairman of Atomic Energy, Homi Bhabha, to Government of India to start space research activities, and it was finally sanctioned. Government agreed in 1961, and they made a committee in COSPAR, Indian National Committee on Space Research. Okay, and Sarabhai was the chairman for this committee, and purpose of this committee was to decide about India's space program, what we should do, how we should do, all that. Then ISRO was formed in 1969 on 15th August, and from 61 to 69 it came under Department of Atomic Energy at PRL, and Department of Space was formed in 1972. That time it got separated from Department of Atomic Energy, and ISRO came under Department of Space. Here you can see a few photographs. The first photograph is a church, basically at Thumba. Thumba is a small village. It used to be a small village near Trivandrum, at the outskirts of the place. And this was the church from where we started our rocket launching. And we used this church as a storeroom for our rocket parts. The first rocket, now it was launched in 1963 from Thumba. Equatorial range. The rocket, of course, it was imported, and then we made our satellite in 1975, and the satellite work was started in Bangalore in 1975 from Peenya at that time, and the satellite was launched by Russians because we were not capable of sending satellite those days. But later on, we developed our own rockets, and we sent our the first satellite Rohini from Sriharikota test range. This is all I am telling because you are students, you like to appear in so many exams, you like to appear in so many interviews, and you like to do lot of research. Many of you may join some companies for a job, and many of you may start their own organization or companies, etc. So you should have a overall idea about all space related activities, how we have progressed. And you see the transportation of the rocket parts. The first time, initially those days, cycle was even very very rare. Very few people used to have cycles, and rocket size were small, and we were able to carry these rocket parts on bicycles. But now our rockets are very very large. We got you can see a part of the rocket on the right side. It is going on a big truck chassis from Trivandrum to Sriharikota. Okay, so so much progress is there in last 50 years. So Indian National Space Promotion and Authorization Center in Space, which has been recently formed by Government of India in 2019. And this body is basically responsible for interacting with the private parties. As I said, that ISRO is bringing a lot of private players to work into the field of space. So in space responsibility is for collaborating with ISRO and using established government facilities, whatever we have. Well, these facilities are very very costly, and all these private companies, they cannot afford. So government wants these private companies, they should use these facilities for making components and for testing these hardwares. Okay, the InSpace has office is in Bangalore. Then we have got the 6 major centers in the country. One is Ahmedabad Space Application Center, which is responsible for making space satellite payloads and space applications. Then second is at Bangalore. This is called UR Rao Satellite Center, where we make the satellite spacecraft structures. Then third is Vikram Sarabhai Space Center, which is responsible for making rockets. for the Satish Dhawan Space Center at Srikota. The main work of SDSC is to launch the satellite. So our satellite payload from Ahmedabad, it goes to Bangalore. Bangalore people integrate with the spacecraft, and the spacecraft then sent to Srikota. And the rocket comes from Trivandrum. It is assembled at Srikota with the satellite, and then Srikota people, they launch it into the space. Then we have got another center, National Remote Sensing Center, which is responsible for all satellite remote sensing projects data, whatever they receive, and they keep it and they distribute to researchers and public. Then we have got ISRO Propulsion Center, which is responsible for making fuels for the rockets. And the latest center is Human Space Flight Center at Bangalore. And this center is basically responsible for the activities related with our human space mission. And you may be knowing the Gaganyaan. Gaganyaan must be reading the newspaper. And we want to send Gaganyaan with 3 astronauts shortly, because of COVID it got delayed. Okay, this is a view in gallery at Srikota. And you can see the control room at the bottom. And this is a gallery where anybody from the country, he can go there to see a live launch from Srikota. Only thing you have to do, prior booking, prior information should be there with ISRO team that you are going. And you can sit in this open gallery, open stadium kind of thing, and you can watch a live launch of a satellite. Then ISRO also has got 2 public sector companies, Antariksh Corporation and New Space India Limited, which is responsible for bringing commercial business to ISRO, to Government of India. Then we have got Space Technology Incubation Centers, because you know, a lot of researchers nowadays, they are working in various engineering colleges, and in New Delhi also they are working, and they want to incubate their ideas. Okay, so what ISRO has taken an initiative, we established 6 incubation center in different NITs. Okay, and they have given the responsibility to each center. And if you have any idea related with the space science and technology, you can contact these centers for incubating your ideas, and all funding goes from Government of India. Then we have got a space innovation center at Odisha. This is at Burla, and Odisha government, they interacted with ISRO, and they have established this center for the development of people of Odisha. They have started this center. Then ISRO also has made recently regional academic centers for space. Other than main ISRO centers, we have got these 6 regional academic centers. And you know, they are in different parts of the country, and ISRO gives funding to them, and responsibility of RAC is to interact with the academic people all over the country and allot them some projects related with space science. Then Government of India is also making a space park. One park has recently come up in the name of Dr. Abdul Kalam at Trivandrum. Then getting a big park at New Delhi in the Pragati Maidan. And I think in all ISRO centers, we have got space related museums. If you visit Ahmedabad, Bangalore, Trivandrum, etc., you can visit and see these stadiums. At Ghaziabad in Uttar Pradesh, which is near Delhi, I also established a small space science gallery as my individual interest, without funding from anyone, so that the people from the rural areas of Uttar Pradesh, of Western UP, they can visit that gallery and have a look on the various model of the satellites, rockets, posters, etc. Then ISRO also has established ISRO chair, and they have established around 5 chairs at IISc Bangalore, Kharagpur, IIT Kharagpur, NIAS Bangalore, Bangalore University, Savitri Phule, Pune University. And purpose is again to bring these academic institutions in the main research line of ISRO. They should do more work related with space science and technology. All fund goes from Government of India. Just it is a figure showing the various places where we establish the chair. Then we have established a center of excellence in advanced mechanics of materials. at Indian Institute of Science. Indian Institute of Science and Studies, ISRO also needs a lot of work, a lot of consultancy related things as far as mechanics is concerned. So this is a joint center where the work is done for all ISRO related jobs. So if you need any help for this, you can contact COE at Indian Institute of Science. I'm not going into the detail because it will take more time, just giving you a first cut idea. Then ISRO also has established Space Technology Cell, that is called STC, for the joint research program. In this they have established in 7 IITs, Delhi, Roorkee, Kanpur, Mumbai, Chennai, Guwahati, Kharagpur. In addition, they have given to Bangalore, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore also. Then again one at Pune University. And there is a coordinator from that institutes, and he takes research proposal from the various staff members of their institute, discuss with them, and then there is a joint committee to review all these projects between ISRO and that space technology cell. Okay, regularly meetings are held, they discuss about the various research projects. These are the locations. So ISRO is trying to distribute all responsibility all over the country. Then recently one Satish Dhawan Center for Space Science, it has been established in Jammu, and their government, they have shown a lot of interest, and there is a central university, it is established there for the progress of that particular area. Then ISRO also has established a Nanoscience and Engineering Center at Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. This Nanoscience Center again may be of interest to the people and the students, those who are related with the physics background. So if you have any proposal, any requirement, you can take help of this CNSC Bangalore. And just you see the figure, if whatever I explained you, and if you see the total map, you will see that we have, ISRO has given something to some state, and it is all over India distributed. Hardly any state is left out. Okay, now ISRO makes various types of satellites like no other countries are making. So we make geostationary satellite, which are used for satellite communication. Then we are making Earth observation satellites. Earth observation satellites, the purpose of this Earth observation satellite is to basically take photographs of the Earth and study that. And we have got a lot of optical cameras into these satellites, and the total work is done by the people who have got physics background. Okay, so I'll call those things later. So then we also make special satellites for various space missions, research purpose, like Chandrayaan, Mangalyaan, Gaganyaan. Okay. Then we have got experimental satellite, that is also called student satellite. ISRO encourages students of various colleges and universities, whether it is a private or government body, to make satellites. So basic responsibility is with the students. They should come forward with an idea to make a satellite, and what they are able to think, they can form a team, discuss with their professors and principals, directors, and submit a proposal to ISRO, and ISRO helps them in realizing these and finalizing the concept, realizing the parts, and finally in launching of the satellites. So around 12 student satellites have already been launched by various institutions. So you can have a look on these two photographs. These photographs are of remote sensing satellite. Basically this satellite is having cameras, optical cameras, which take a lot of photographs. 24 hours they take photograph of the Earth of various places. And why they take photograph, what they do with these photographs, I'll explain a little later. You can see we have got all solar panels. We can the left side. And the right side you can see multi-layer insulation, a golden color, total satellite is wrapped. So to avoid transfer of heat, we use multi-layer insulation. And these satellites are around 900 kg, 1 ton or 1200 kg kind of thing. small satellites, and these are the communication satellites. They are bigger in size, and weight wise also they are more than 2 tons. Okay, and we carry a lot of antennas and equipments for satellite communication, etc. This was a scientific satellite, Chandrayaan 2. Everybody of you may be knowing about it. We launched with a lander and rover, and 2 years back, and the orbital part of is very, very successful. The satellite is still orbiting and sending a lot of data to us. Only the lander part we did not get success. So ISRO is also planning next Chandrayaan 3 to carry to do that job, whatever was left out. Okay. Now satellite launch vehicle. Satellite launch vehicle is nothing but is a kind of rocket. So rocket is a very popular word. And how to launch the satellite? We use these particular vehicles. In 1980, India became the 6th nation in the world to launch its own satellite with own rocket ASLV. Okay, we developed this rocket and it was launched from Sriharikota. So that is why our first spacecraft, Aryabhatta, I said it was launched by Russia, because that time in 1975 we were not having capability of launching. So more than 100 launches made by Indian from Sriharikota, and we are now capable of sending 4-ton class of satellite. It means the satellite is weighing 4 ton, we can send that satellite into a geosynchronous orbit. And when the first satellite was launched, it was around 40 kg. So from 40 kg to 4 ton, 4000 kg, that is the progress in the last 50 years. So can have a look on this various rockets developed by India. The first one, ASLV, which we had developed first, and we were able to send around 40 kg weight to the space. Then we got PSLV, then GSLV, then GSLV Mark 3. So PSLV is a rocket, polar satellite launch vehicle, where we can send satellite, remote sensing satellite mostly, into the range of 800 to 900 kilometers orbit. And these satellite can weigh around 1200 to 2000 kgs. Okay, and this is the most successful rocket of the world, PSLV, and India has launched more than 100, and I think only one failure is there. So success rate is also more. Many countries are coming to India to launch their satellites using PSLV because the cost is also low, reliability is high. Then we have got GSLV, geosynchronous launch vehicle, by which we can send the satellite into 36,000 kilometer orbit. Okay, and in GSLV Mark 3 we have got our own cryogenic engines developed by India, and this is the most powerful rocket which India has. So we can launch up to 4 ton, and later on we are planning up to 5 to 6 tons weight class of satellite to launch. As I said, the PSLV already explained, we made a world record of 104 satellites a few years back, and that was with the help of PSLV only. And with the help of GSLV, we launched our Chandrayaan 2. We used GSLV Mark 3. Earlier, we used to import cryogenic engines, but later on it was stopped and we developed. We took around 10 years to develop these engines. So the next mission, manned space missions, Gaganyaan, we will be sending through GSLV Mark 3. I can see this is the example photograph of a cryogenic engine which we have developed. The main engine is called as Vikas engine, and this is a scaled model of the Vikas engine which we have kept at Ahmedabad in our space museum. And these engines have been developed indigenously, and Godrej at Bombay, that company has come forward. They are doing lot of parts, fabricating lot of parts of Vikas engine at Bombay. Okay, now you can see when a satellite is launched, when the rocket goes up, a lot of heat is generated, lot of flames are generated. Okay, So to control these flames and the temperature rise, if we don't control this temperature rise at the time of launch, our the launch pad and other equipments nearby, they will get burnt. So a lot of harmful effects. So we'll have to use the materials which are flame proof, which can sustain those temperatures. And we have got a lot of water jets. You can see at the bottom, other than the flames, we have got a lot of water jets, and the water is sprinkled as the rocket goes up to cool down. So everywhere in this temperature control generation, the role of physics people is there. This is the top part of our rocket. Okay, you can see left and right side, these are called heat shield, you know? And the center of a rocket is there, where as soon as this rocket appears, crosses our Earth gravitational limits, it enters that, our heat shield will get separated and it will get burned, and the satellite will come in, and it will be pushed into the space. Okay, heat shield we use to protect our satellite at the time of entry. This is, you can see the satellite where we have got four satellites, okay, A, B, C, D. There are four satellites, three are very small satellite in comparison to satellite A, and in the one mission, one launch itself, we can launch four satellites. We do nowadays four satellites, seven satellites, 104, we have already made a record, Russia has broken that record, this and lot of things. So this is very, very interesting and challenging. How to send multi-satellite from single launch so that we can save the cost. So India's a few missions, SSLV, small satellite launch vehicle, which we are developing, and basically this total technology we want to give to a private company like L&T or some other companies, they have shown interest. Then we got Chandrayaan 3 project, originally planned in December 2020, and it is delayed by 2 to 3 years because of COVID. Then same Gaganyaan also has got delayed. We have already selected three astronauts from India. They have been trained in Russia, and their space suits now is under preparation by a company in Russia. So NISAR, NISAR is a project between NASA and ISRO. We are making a synthetic aperture radar, and it is expected in 2022. It is a joint project. Then ISRO is planning to go in future on Venus and Jupiter, and then reusable launch vehicles, and it is kind of space shuttle kind of thing. This I have already explained. This is a reusable launch vehicle, just a pic. We have already developed the basic technology in 2016. Now it takes around 10 to 15 years to make a full-fledged space shuttle kind of thing. Already my team is working on that. It needs a lot of money and time. Okay, space, we have got a lot of important applications, not only for the scientists in here, but for the common man. And just I have written a few. If I cover all these applications, it takes another 1.5 hours. So I'm not going to cover this application part of it, but in brief, I will tell you there are large number of applications by which our the common man of the country is benefited. That is in the field of tele education, telemedicine, communication, disaster monitoring, navigation, NAVIC, which you call as GPS, everybody has got in his mobile, then crop forecasting, cartography, river interlinking, etc. So just for an idea, I'm showing this slide, and there are lot many applications on this. So government of India has taken a lot of initiative. They have discussed with all the secretaries of the various departments, and there was a presentation was made to them. So finally they selected 170 projects where they say space technology can be used for better governance, and all departments have been instructed. Academic institutions also have been instructed to take more and more interest into the research of space science and technology. They should help ISRO for future programs. Okay, let us see now space hardware. When we develop, what are the various things to develop a hardware, a product, we need first is concept. We will have to do the conceptualization. okay, whether it is a satellite, it is a rocket or any application, then we'll have to design, do the analysis. So the first part itself, the conceptualization, it mainly comes from the scientists who have got physics background. So physics is a branch like a mechanical engineering, which plays a very important role everywhere. Okay. Then we go after that, our design analysis, we go for manufacturing. For manufacturing, we do ourselves. Then we also involve various industries into this. Then when the component is ready, system is ready, we do a lot of assemblies and testing. This assembly and testing is usually done in ISRO centers because this facility is very, very costly. And after that, the final product is developed. This product is delivered to the satellite team and launch. So, as I said, ISRO is taking a lot of help, or rather interacting with many government departments like DST, DAE. Then we interact with public sector companies, BHEL, Bharat Electronics, TCL, etc. Then we interact with academic institutions like IITs, IEC, government, a lot of private colleges. So in future, let us say, hopefully, your college also will show a lot of interest into the space research, and you will interact with ISRO for future projects. So why academic advantage is there to interact with academic people? Because they are good in making concepts. Academic people are good in design analysis. They can do process development. They can do software development. They can do advanced research and development. And they can be involved into the space education and awareness. As you know, in India, as on today, there is no institute, no college, no school where space education is taught. But while in other countries, they have started at school level itself to tell the young kids about the space. Okay, so these academic institutions, they can come forward and make a lot of programs related with space education and awareness at all levels, at under UG level and PG level. Academic students have got a lot of good things which you will not find in other government departments, offices and companies. They get a lot of problems. You have got very young people, young students in the colleges. They have got very bright ideas, new ideas. Okay, you have research scholars in various universities and colleges. They work very hard for their research. Then we got experienced faculty, and faculty, you know, they are supposed to be good in all theoretical knowledge. They read a lot of papers, do a lot of calculations. They have got a well-equipped lab, library, computing facility, etc. So considering all this, government is thinking to involve more and more academic institutions into the R&D world. Okay, just a few, I'll go a little fast, so you should not get bored. Ground-based systems, you know, basically we have got ground-based systems, then we have got aerospace-based system, then we have got a space-based system. So at ground, we do a lot of design and manufacturing works. We make various parts, subsystems. After that, we test. Okay, then we do the assembly, integration, everything, then control. The total thing is controlled from the ground, whatever we send into the space. So we have got tracking station. We have to transport satellite from one place to another place. It is a very big challenge. Then transportation of launch vehicle by road, as I have shown one figure from Trivandrum to Sriharikota, large size of rockets. It is a really very big challenge to transport all these rockets. Then some of the satellites will have to transport not to within India, but outside India also for launching. Very special satellite. You know, sometimes we go to the Russia, sometimes we go to the ESA for the launch. Then handling of satellites within centers from one place to another place, how to handle the satellite, they should not get damaged. We'll have to avoid from the rain, water, dust, shocks, everything. Okay. This is a chamber now, which is used for testing of the total satellite and subsystems. This is called thermovac test chambers. Okay. Why it is important? They are very big. If you see engineering point of view, they have got a lot of infrastructure into this. and this is a very costly facility which we have got at Ahmedabad and Bangalore. Okay, so as I said, space, there is a vacuum and there is a temperature variation from minus to plus. So we create all that in this chamber. So first we will cool our spacecraft and we go up to the minus 80 degree centigrade and we test our system. Then immediately this same chamber, it will become hot. It goes up to 180 degree centigrade and that too in vacuum condition. So vacuum is also created in this. That is why it is important. And then we test our do all the electrical test when it is in chamber. So we see that our satellite is working properly. All the systems are working properly. This is another satellite which is being tested, JUICE spacecraft, vertically taken down. Okay, the similar type kind of facility was very costly facility. Then we do vibration test of a lot of equipments, satellites. Each and every equipment is tested on a vibration table. These vibration facility we have got in Bangalore, Ahmedabad and Trivandrum. We test all of the systems just to see whether any nut and bolt or any wire, any soldering connection is loose or not. If something is loose, it will break during vibration. So before launching, we repair that. Then we do make a lot of fixtures for testing. This is the antenna system being tested. These mechanical engineers get a lot of interest into this. Then electrically, this testing antenna is being tested. You know, right side there is a photograph which is available, very popular on internet. When we made our first satellite, Apple, that time we were not having these kind of labs. So we wanted to test our satellite antenna system where there should not be any metal nearby and no disturbance. So it was tested on a wooden bullock cart. Okay. And you can see left side, this is our first antenna, which was established in 1967. It was imported from Japan. Total design fabrication was done by them. And right side, you can see over the mobile van. This was the first OB van of the country. You know, everybody, all of you may be knowing OB vans now, which is used by these reporters, press team. And nowadays, these vans have become very, very small. Antenna has become small. Electronics have become very small, compact. And this we made sometime in 1975. And transportation and handling of satellite, we make metallic container to transport the satellite from one place to another. We also make inflatable type of structures which are pressurized, and we can avoid the satellite from dust, rain and other things. So everywhere, making pressurization system, making inflatable system, the important role of physics people. Then we make a lot of handling fixtures from one place to another place. Okay, this is not of interest for physics people, but there is a big challenge in transporting rockets from one place to another place. As I said, within India, there are four photographs. Earlier I shown two. You can see we have very, very large size of trailers. We don't have roads in the country to take these trailers. So when they go on the road, it is very difficult. Our total team goes after these trailers. Then we have got satellite launch pads from where we launch our satellites. We have got two, one at Sriharikota. It is the oldest. And second one is coming up, Tuticorin in Tamil Nadu. At Sriharikota, we have got two launch pads, launch pad 1 and launch pad 2. So because when we assemble one satellite, it takes around 1 month for the total assembly. In the meantime, when it is launched, we prepare the assembly of the second satellite. So every month at least, we have one launch. The load is very much increasing. We have got getting foreign satellites also for launching. You can see this photograph. We have got rocket at the center is being lifted. You can see the fumes, and around that there are four towers. It's a very big challenge for mechanical and structural engineers to make these towers. And the top of it is, you can see the 1, 2, 3, 4. These are on the four towers. These are lightning arresters which are used for the protection of rocket. You can see these lightning arresters above the level of rocket. So if any lightning attack is there, these are absorbed by our lightning arresters. So let us see about the space-based systems. What are these? Space, main most important is the spacecraft which goes into the space. So this photograph you can see these spacecraft structure right inside made by Bangalore people, and we put a lot of payloads on that, which you can see in the left side photograph. Lot of antennas, equipment, sensor, etc. on the satellite. These are made of honeycomb sandwich panel, which are covered with carbon fibers reinforced plastics. Okay, so it makes the system very, very light and very, very strong. These are the payload parts, which are all designed and made in Ahmedabad. You can see the multi-layer boxes, 1, 2, 3, 4. These are electronic boxes where circuit is mounted. Then we have got antenna system, feed system. Bottom side, you can see the cameras. They are made in all lightweight materials and with good conductivity. We plate these boxes with the gold to avoid EMC, EMI problem. Okay. Okay, another view of these boxes. They're very precise boxes, very precisely manufactured, and PCBs are assembled into these. These are the subjects, various subjects which are of interest to the mechanical people. A lot of challenges into that. So many engineering colleges, IITs, they are working on all these kind of problems. And thermal system, we have mechanical as well as physics people work on that. The thermal control of the satellite is very, very important and very challenging. Predicting temperature on the satellite, how much at what time, how much temperature will be there on the satellite is a very challenging job. Then what are the thermal load distribution, then orbital load calculations, multi-layer insulation, everywhere or physics people, they are helping. Why we need a thermal control system? I think maybe knowing all electronic components can work under a limited temperature range. Every 10 degree increase causes reduction in life to half. So we'll have to maintain the temperature. If we don't maintain temperature and if it increases, the life of the component reduces. Okay. Same way, electrolytes life increases at low temperature. Even the rocket fuels also, if temperature increases, we cannot store more fuel in the rocket. We'll have to make very big size rockets. So that is why we go for the cryogenic. At the cryogenic temperatures, we store the fuel. So in the less space, we can store more fuel. So that is why the challenge is there in cryogenic engine. For the material scientists, those who are from metallurgy and other fields, they show a lot of interest. Even mechanical people show interest. Other than that, lot of physics people, they are interested in many of these type of materials, like low or zero coefficient of thermal expansion materials, RF transparent materials. Many people are working, physics scientists, on these type of there. Then shape memory alloy, this is called smart materials. Okay, they are named being self-healing materials. Then thermal insulation, other than that, conductive and non-conductive materials. So the interest, it is, you can say nowadays, interdisciplinary type of field where materials people, polymer science people, mechanical and physics people, they work in developing advanced materials. You can see there is a upcoming field of mining people, and there is a good scope of space mining. People say there are a lot of very good ores in the moon and Mars surface. So people and very many asteroids. Okay, so it contains a lot of uranium and gold, etc. So everybody is after that. So many people have interest in that. So same way, some people say that what is the scope of civil engineer? No, civil engineers also are equally important for space related, space organization. They recruit many civil engineers and very important work is there for them. Okay, even remote sensing is a part of civil engineering, which is taught by some of the universities, some of the IITs, and that are used for various plannings. same way. Chemical engineering, you know, especially fuel part of it, will have to develop very, very efficient fuels. So these chemical engineers, chemistry people, then metallization of the various components, they work electroforming, resins, adhesives. Same way, electrical, electronics and communication. You know, earlier electrical used to be separate, electronics used to be separate. Later on, it's all even electrical and electronics combined. If people are working, hardcore electrical work in the country is reducing. So, lot of electronics. Then IT has come up separately. So, this is very challenging work for electronics and communication team, where the physics people also contribute a lot. Then IT and computer science, they do a lot of now cloud computing is coming up, internet software system, security of data, and number of fields, transfer of data at high speed from satellite to the ground is very, very challenging, you know. And now we are going to get high speed internet, and this internet will not come directly from the cables. This high speed internet will come directly from the satellite. So things will become very, very simple. We are talking about 5G, 6G kind of thing. And the all CDs, pen drives, they'll become obsolete. Directly anything you can download within microseconds. Then a lot of softwares are to be developed. So there's another scope for the IT people only. They are working for a lot of technical and administrative softwares in the various offices. And moon rovers, space robotics, can say moon rovers. There is a lot of scope. Many countries are making, you know, already Mars, there is a rover must be reading daily. It is already moving on the surface of the Mars, they are sending daily some photographs. So India is also now planning planned basically for a rover which was supposed to move on the moon surface, but it was not successful. And there is a lot of scope in making moon rovers in the country, and I think IT Kanpur has shown some interest into this. Same with the making landers and rovers. Still, a very few countries have got success into this. And then space debris is a very coming. As you know, we have got debris or waste material at the ground. Earth people have spoiled everywhere. You will find solid waste, and government is taking a lot of action. How to fight with this debris. So earlier, when the first satellite was launched in 1957 in space, there was no debris at all. It was very neat and clean. But slowly, when human beings started working for space, sending rockets, satellites, now there are so many more than 8,000 metric ton as on January 1st, 2020. That much scrap is lying in space, and it is very, very difficult to remove. Even our scientists are working daily. They are thinking, the various groups have been made on space debris and how to remove these debris, how to reduce that. Okay, but it is a very, very difficult job. And these debris are very, very harmful. At a very high speed they move, and if when they collide with any of the system, our satellite system, it damage. Okay. You can see this photograph, 1957, the Earth, it was total, neat and clean, you can see the Earth. Then our satellites have started, artificial satellite. Next 2005, you see all white dots are nothing but artificial satellites. 2018, see the condition. And in 2030, the Earth will be small, and all around so many satellites will be there. Okay, so maintaining this satellite is another challenge, and debris removal is another challenge. Everywhere scientists are thinking seriously how to remove that. Okay, then you know this NASA company, Elon Musk, Tesla, they made a rocket which is a reusable rocket. So far the rockets which we made, they are not reusable. India does not have any reusable rocket, and many countries don't have, and only a few countries have made this, like America made a space shuttle kind of thing. and which was reusable. It went to the space and then came back on the earth, so that you can save the cost. Russia also made in 1988, they had only one flight of this flight. It was a successful flight, but later on they have not flown any space shuttle. Reason is not known to anyone. So SpaceX, they are making Falcon 9 rocket, and India is also thinking of making reusable launch vehicles. Okay, so here also the people, the young brain can contribute how to make these reusable rockets, how the rocket goes up, send the satellite and comes back on the ground. This is a photograph of India's space shuttle which we are developing. You can see we'll have to master this technique. If we'll have to compete the international market, we'll have to make the satellite launching very, very economical, at par with the other countries. Otherwise they will take the market and our launching cost will be very, very high. And there's a good scope in the business also, and there are a lot of people are working into the space business. They want to launch satellites, take the market of other countries. India is also working very hard. We have made InSpace for getting good space business from other countries. A few slides on the students' contribution in the country. And there were VOM 1 and VOM 2, two rockets, sounding rockets, which were made by students of engineering. And they were at Trivandrum. They designed, made these rockets, and it was launched by ISRO in front of these students as a part of their project. So ISRO encourages. So you can also plan at your place this kind of thing, either rocket or satellite. As I said initially, student satellites, around 12 student satellites have been launched. ANUSAT, you know, SRM University has made, and NIT University has made, IIT Kanpur, then IIT Roorkee is planning, then Chang'e University is planning, and so many. And ISRO will help you in finalizing the concept, designing the satellite, and launching. So, initiative should come from the young students. Recently, I think last year, some school students in Chennai, they sent one small satellites. Okay. Of course, some money has to come from the management, school management. And this is a 2008 newspaper clipping. No, there was a competition organized by NASA for rovers. Okay, the engineering college people, Delhi College of Engineering, they made a rover, very crude model, you can see. And these people were called to NASA. They took it, displayed there, and got an award also for their rover. And just very, very old, 2008. Now all the technology has changed. Many students are showing interest into this. Let us say what are the other important opportunities for science student and researchers. You are waiting since long. I have listed 18 areas. I actually list go enroll in all sciences to do any job in space, and physics is involved. So basic initiative is taken by physics. Basic importance is given to the physics people. They only think, finalize the concept, and then it is realized by the engineers. Okay, now just go through this list. They play important role in remote sensing of Earth. It means on Earth we have got land, sea, mountain, rivers. We do the remote sensing, physics people. Astronomy, astrophysics, physics people. This is all done at physical research lab and all. Physical research lab in the Earth comes under Department of Space, responsible for doing all this work. And study of Sun and planets, study of Moon, Mars, okay, and oceanography and marine life we do with the help of satellites. Then space habitation. You see, people are thinking in future we'll have to go to the Moon and stay there. We'll make a colony there where human beings will stay there. So all that is being thought of by physics people, how to stay, what type of things will be there, how much comfortable it will be. Same way they are also thinking about the Mars. Then I said environmental testing, vibration and vacuum test, electronic system. You know, a lot of people MSc electronics. Physics, it is a branch of physics only. Then sensor, we use electronics also plays a very important role into this. Then cryogenic, it is low temperature science. Cryogenic, which is used for developing engines and cryocoolers. Then electro-optics, we have got a lot of people who work in the optics. They are developing very good cameras, lenses, etc. for spacecrafts. Then metrology people for weather prediction, and number of scientists are working. If you go to the IMD, all physics people are there. They go to the SAC, all physics people are there. They are working a very big group on metrology. They take a lot of photographs, 24 hours photographs are taken, and they are predicting weather. Okay, all the weather predictions are done. Then how crop productions are done, crop, how can we predict? That is again based on science, space technology. We predict the crops. Okay, this year how much wheat will be there, this year how much rice will be there. Everything is done by all physics background people. Then important is orbital calculations. So whenever we are sending, you know, a rocket, when we send, how much speed should be there, you know, then initial laws, Kepler laws, all physics people. Then escape velocity, then in the orbit how satellites have to move, at what speed they will move, how they will collide, okay, and how we'll do docking. And these calculations in the orbit is very, very, very important, and all physics people are working. There's hardly any field where physics is not playing any role, okay. And if you find it useful, I can even give this presentation later on to you, so that you should know which are the good topics to work. And a few Indian space scientists, those who are from physics background, a few only I listed big scientists. Like first is Vikram Sarabhai. He did his MSc physics, then later on PhD. Professor U.R. Rao, he was chairman of ISRO. Okay, he did his PhD from Gujarat University Physical Research Lab. Then Professor Kasturi Rangan, he also did his PhD from Physical Research Lab. Those days, except PRL, nothing was there. For physics people, they know the importance of Physical Research Lab. Then our A.S. Kiran Kumar, he is also a basically physics graduate. And you know, Professor Rao, Professor Kasturi Rangan, Kiran Kumar, all three are from Karnataka. All three are from Karnataka. Then we have got R.R. Nawalgund. He is a space scientist and from physics ground. He did his PhD from Bombay IIT and his basic education in near Hubli, that Dharwad. He is also from Karnataka. Then we got Professor Yashpal, the famous scientist, Professor Chitnis, Professor Bhausar, Ajay, and so many directors, chairmen who are working in Physical Research Lab. They are also from physics background. So all of you are quite fortunate enough that you are from that physics background working. There's a good amount of scope. You one day you can become a big scientist like these people and contribute for the country. You can see some of the photographs of this famous space scientist. Second photo is Mr. Kiran Kumar, who is from Karnataka. And last photograph in the first line is Kasturi Rangan. He is also from Karnataka. Then Professor Rao, second row, first photograph, he is also from Karnataka. And these all scientists had physics background. Okay. Now another important thing is, this year on August 23, ISRO announced, that announcement of opportunity, ISRO announced and wrote to many science related institutions in the country, universities, because they wanted to have a conference where all these science people should be there and they wanted to discuss about the data received by our Chandrayaan 2. Even Chandrayaan 1 also, we have got very good data. ISRO is getting good data from various satellites. We need science-based people, researchers to analyze that data. Okay. So ISRO on August 23rd, they announced the announcement of opportunity for Chandrayaan 2 data. Then they organize a conference on 6th and 7th September. It was a 2 days lunar science workshop and release of Chandrayaan 2 data. So it means the students, research scholars, faculty people, all from physics background, they attended this lunar science workshop. ISRO presented the data, explained them okay, what is the data, how much data is there, and how important this data is there, and what they can do using this data. Okay, this data is freely available, and those who are doing any research or have interest from your college also, they can also contact ISRO. You can take this data, and many people, they have done their PhDs in based on the Chandrayaan 2 data. Okay. It was all Indian scientific community was benefited out of this. Then ISRO opened up its scientific discussions on lunar science to the people of the country to engage the Indian academia, institutes, students and people from all disciplines and walks of life. Okay. Even people don't know that this much data is available and from where this data they can get. Okay. The lunar workshop delivered the big news of bunch of discovery, you know, class of findings by Chandrayaan 2. Many discoveries are there. The most important was we were the first to find out that there is a water on moon. It is deposited. It is in the ice form. And first time India declared that, it was published in Nature magazine, and later on it was confirmed by NASA and other people. So we had our on Chandrayaan 2 mass spectrometer, CHASE-2, that is the name, in its pursuit to conduct first ever in situ study of the composition of the lunar neutral exposure from a polar orbiter platform. It is a polar orbiter platform, it means it rotates around the moon. It detected and studied the variability of the argon 40 at moon. So they think there a lot of argon is available on moon. So they put various types of sensors, various types of payload, they design and they put finally on the spacecraft. It gets those data sent back to us, and then we analyze that data and do the proper study. Then we declare. So they say a lot of chromium is there, manganese is there on the lunar surface. There was another payload called GLASS, which was for this particular purpose, to find out chromium and manganese. So accordingly, sensors are designed. What do you want to find? The first ever, as I said, hydroxyl and water ice on the lunar surface. It was discovered by ISRO team. Okay, then we have got a dual frequency synthetic aperture radar. It was again on this Chandrayaan 2. Okay. Then we have got terrain mapping cameras, which has found very interesting geological signatures. The science data which has been received by Chandrayaan 2 and other satellites. Okay, so we have made one center that is called Indian Space Science Data Center. It is at Bangalore, Karnataka, at Bailalu, and they store all this data there. Okay, so if anybody wants that data, ISRO can give easily this data. Okay, so the question received from the academia institutes, the people, those who attended that workshop, and our ISRO chairman was there, he answered to all. Then opportunity for youngsters. So what I say, ki in space there are good opportunities for all. Okay, we have got good opportunities for science people and physics on the top priority. But if you just go through the list, there are various branches of engineering and science who are playing important role. So anybody can join ISRO or any other related organization. There are a lot of private companies, other organization are coming who are going to do research into that, and they can be absorbed. Even we have got opportunities for arts and commerce people, and other than arts and commerce, we have got opportunities for even law people. You know, there is space law, a separate subject is coming up for space law nowadays. So how to have interact, just a few slides more, just bear with me. So ISRO interacts with all academic institutions in various ways. First is sponsored research. Under this, any engineering college, any university can submit a research proposal to ISRO for a joint research, and ISRO gives fund of around 20-30 lakhs to the institute. To the institute, not an individual. We give funds to the institute, and you can carry out research which is useful to ISRO at your institute. Then we establish ISRO chair, we establish RAC, we have, next is DPC. DPC is Departmental Promotion Committees. So whenever DPCs are there, our committees are there, so we call experts from the academic institutions to take part into that promotion committee. Then we invite people from academic institution in the design review. We have got design review committees. Whenever we take up a design of a new system, we invite experts from the many academic institutions. It is not from IITs, even from a small engineering college or science college also, we can invite if somebody is an expert into that. Then through space technology cell, we interact. We have got various technology cell, they can submit. Then we lot of GRF are recruited into ISRO. They can do research. Then we give training to students, and they can work their PG projects, dissertations, and SAC. And there are many professional societies. I'll cover in a new separate slide. With them, you can interact. So this is a list of the many academic institutions which are already working with ISRO for various projects, and hopefully your college also will show interest, and your name will be added in this list. Okay, ISRO on the website, they have put a Yukti Sanchita. It is a 84 page document released in March 2021 by Chairman ISRO. It contains a lot of list of projects, research topics, okay, which are of interest to scientists and engineers from various academic institutions and industry. You can go through that. If you find anything interesting where you can do the research, you can contact them. Okay, this is free of charge available, a PDF copy on website. So these are some of the professional societies which are working into the space science development in the country, and mostly as I said, first four, ISRS, IMS, ISG, and SCRF, all most of them are from physics background. Indian Society of Remote Sensing, Meteorological Society, Society of Geomagnetic Magnetics, and Space Education Research Forum, and they have got their local chapters at many big cities. For preparing all this lecture, I have taken help from ISRO website, PRL website, and local newspapers. I like to acknowledge. This is my last slide. My phone number and email ID is there. So if you have any doubt, or if you want to ask anything even later, any guidance, feel free to send me an email. I will be happy to help you. Thank you very much for patient hearing.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Now the session is open for the interaction. Now I call our head of the Department of Physics, Dr. Pierre Jigal, sir, to have the interaction with. Hello, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yes.
Now I request our HOD, sir, to interact with the resource person.
Mathur, sir.
Yes, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
I'm going to interact and connect with what no subject, sir.
Yeah.
The only I came to appreciate your enthusiasm and curiosity to render the knowledge to the young, sir, young yeah. people. And really, it is an inspiring talk. And definitely, the students who are really aspirants in the space science really got the benefit, sir. I'm very, very thankful to you, sir. And I really appreciate your interest to ignite the interest yeah. in the young minds.
Yes.
That is most necessary, sir, nowadays.
Yeah.
And a lot of curiosity among the students.
Hmm.
But they are not getting the right inspiration. And by means of you people, the people like you, sir, definitely they are inspired and they are going to do something miracles in the days to come, sir. Actually, it is thought-provoking and wonderful information you have delivered. And even after your retirement, and you are having such a wonderful interest, it is very commendable, sir. I am very thankful to your service and also your interest and your dedication towards the field. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the nice words. Actually, the time when we joined ISRO,
yes,
40
sir.
Years back, there was no internet, no Google, and there was no literature available related to space science sector technology. We were totally new. So we learned from experience, a lot of things from our experience, from experiments, and because foreign countries also, they don't share much literature. Now the time has changed. For the young generation, there are people to guide them. There are people to tell them, Google is available. Okay. Communication has become very easy. Lot of literature, Chinese and Russian, it is available in English nowadays. Earlier, that problem was also there. So we were not able to read those kind of literature. So still, India has to do a lot of good things. Very big projects have to be done. I think the young students, those who are attending these programs, they would be able to contribute and see all that. We may not be there that time, but these people, they have to take the country at higher and higher. And hopefully, they can, by contribution of these young students, India will become number one in the whole world. And I thank all of you also for supporting and getting interaction with the students.
Sir, I'm anyway, in the days to come, sir, we are planning a lecture series, sir.
Okay.
That, I think just by seeing your profound knowledge in the field of space science, so that I thought that I'm going to arrange the lecture series
okay.
for the students. Hmm. And so that definitely I'm going to invite you, sir. And at that time, there is the authoritatively or, you know, that is the with affection, I'm requesting you, sir. Definitely you have to accept our invitation and
sure,
we are
sure.
going to intimate you, sir.
Yeah.
Hmm. Thank you very much,
okay.
sir.
Thank
for
you.
Your dedicated service to the field, sir.
Hmm.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Now I request for proposing word of thanks.
Hi, sir.
Hello.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah. Good afternoon.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. You were the instrumental for arranging this talk.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you, sir. Veena okay. is there, no, sir. That's why instrument
yeah.
is there.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you, sir. I take this opportunity to thank Honorable Chairman and member of Board of Management, Kelly Society, for the support. And I thankful to our resource person, you, sir, Anil C. Mathur, sir, for his outstanding delivery, by means of which our students got so much of enrichable knowledge about the space science. And I extend my thanks to my beloved principal sir and my HOD sir, Dr. L.D. Horkari and Dr. P.R. Jirgal for this organizing this wonderful national seminar, sir. And thank you, sir.
Thanks to all.
Thank you for your hello. Thank you. Now I am sending the feedback link to all the participants. So kindly fill the feedback link and give us to conduct such a seminars in the future. Thank you one and all. And even after submitting the feedback, you will get the certificate of participation. Hope you will get the certificate and all. Thank you. Thank you one and all.